after considerations, we will switch towards curriculum framework. Next point. Curriculum framework can be defined as a group of related subjects or themes which fit together according to a predetermined set of criteria to appropriately cover an area of study. Each curriculum framework has the potential to provide structure for designing subjects and a rationale and policy context for subsequent curriculum development of these subjects. It also refers to an organized plan or set of standards or learning outcomes that defines the content to be learned in terms of clear definable standard of what the student should know and be able to do. It is a part of outcome based education or standards based education reform design. The framework is the second step defining clear high standards which will be achieved by all students. The curriculum is then aligned to the standards and the students are assessed against these standards. Sixth point of the discussion is models of curriculum development. There are number of models of curriculum development, but for today's discussion we will consider two. One, the Tyler model, and second will be Hilda Tabbas model. Now, first the Tyler model. One of the best known curriculum model is the Tyler model, introduced in 1949 by Ralph Tyler in his classic book Basic Principles of Curriculum and Instruction, in which he asked four questions. Number one, what educational purposes should the institutions keep to attain? Two, what educational experiences can be provided that are likely to attain these purposes? Third, how can these educational experiences be effectively organized? And fourth, how can we determine whether these purposes are being attained? Hence, the four steps suggested by Tyler are: formulation of educational objectives, selecting learning experiences, effective and efficient organization of learning experiences, of course, theory and practicals, and fourth is evaluation of curriculum. Now, Hilda Tabbas model. Another approach to curriculum development was proposed by Hilda Tabbas in her book Curriculum Development, Theory and Practice, published in 1962. She argued that there was a definite order in creating a curriculum. She believed that teachers who teach the curriculum should participate in developing it, which led to the model being called as grassroots approach. She noted seven major steps to her grassroots model, in which teachers would have major input. She was of the opinion that the Tyler model was more of an administrative model. Now, her steps: diagnosis of the need. The teacher, who is also the curriculum designer, starts the process by identifying the needs of students for whom the curriculum is planned. For example, the majority of students are unable to think critically. Number two, formulation of objectives. After the teacher has identified needs that require attention, he or she specifies objectives to be accomplished. Number 3, selection of content. The objectives selected or created suggest the subject matter or content of the curriculum. Not only should the objectives and content match, but also the validity and significance of content chosen needs to be determined, that is, the relevance and significance of the content. Fourth is organization of content. A teacher cannot just select content, but must organize it in some way of sequence, taking into consideration the maturity of learners, their academic achievement, and their interests. And fifth step is selection of learning experiences. Content must be presented to students, and students must be engaged with the content. At this point, the teacher selects instructional methods that will involve the students with the content. Sixth step is organization of learning activities. Just as content must be sequenced and organized, so must the learning activities. Often, the sequence of learning activities is determined by content, but the teacher needs to keep in mind the particular students whom he or she will be teaching. And last step is evaluation and means of evaluation. The curriculum planner must determine just what objectives have been accomplished. Evaluation procedures need to be designed to evaluate learning outcomes. From these 7 steps, it is clear that Hilda Taba gives process of curriculum into 4 components. Number 1, planning. Number 2, designing. Number 3, organizing. And number 4 is evaluation of the curriculum. Before discuss it in detail, we will consider types of curriculum design. There are 3 basic types of curriculum design: subject-centered design, learner-centered design, and problem-centered design. Subject-centered curriculum design revolves around a particular subject matter or discipline, such as mathematics, literature, or biology. This type of design describes what needs to be studied and how it should be studied. Core curriculum is an example of a subject-centered design which can be standardized across educational institutions, states, and the country as a whole. The standardized core curricula, teachers are provided a predetermined list of things that they need to teach their students, along with specific examples of how these things should be taught. The primary drawback is that it focuses on the subject rather than the student. This form of curriculum design is constructed without taking into account the specific learning style of the students. This can cause problems with student engagement and motivation. Second type of curriculum design is learner-centered curriculum. This design is based on student needs, interests, and goals. It acknowledges that students are not uniform but individual, and therefore should not, in all cases, be subject to a standardized curriculum. This approach aims to empower learners to shape their education through choices. Differentiated instructional plans provide an opportunity to select assignments, teaching and learning experiences or activities. This form of curriculum design has been shown to engage and motivate students. The drawback is that it can create pressure of the educator to source materials specific to each student's learning needs. This can be challenging due to teaching time constraints. Balancing individual student interest with the institution's required outcomes could prove to be a daunting task. Third design of curriculum development is problem-centered curriculum design. This type of design teaches students how to look at a problem and formulate a solution. Considered an authentic form of learning because students are exposed to real life issues, this model helps student skills and that are transferable to the real world. Problem-centered curriculum design has been shown to increase the relevance of the curriculum and encourages creativity, innovation, and collaboration in the classroom. The drawback of this format is that it does not always consider individual learning styles.